Welcome back to the course on HRD, and we are in the process of knowing about the various HRD evaluation process. In the last episode, we discussed about human resource development audit, the difference between HR audit and HRD audit, the process, objectives, the benefits to the organization and the employees, and the companies which have implemented HRD audit as a part of their work process. Today's episode, we are going to learn about benchmarking, the different types of benchmarking as an evaluation tool, and balanced scorecard and its application in the HRD evaluation. Now, what is benchmarking? We have come across this concept in strategic management and management principles. It is a technique that uses quantitative and qualitative data to make comparisons between different organizations and different sections of the organizations. It is actually fixing up a standard and seeing whether and trying whether we can achieve that particular standard. So it may use quantitative and qualitative data. It is usually a continuous process through which organizations periodically measure, challenge and improve their practices. So it is one of the methods by which best practices are adopted by the organization. Benchmarking is a term which is often used to describe performance assessment and which seeks to assess the competencies of the organization against the best in class. Usually, the performance outputs are defined in quantitative terms, in terms of financial performance, key financial ratio, measures of output, market. There are also more qualitative and less tangible features of performance which result on quality or satisfaction of customers. Assessment of these features is more difficult and it can only be done by direct observation or survey. Benchmarking should include both qualitative and quantitative measures of performance, and its emphasis should be on a continuous basis. There are two kinds of benchmarking: internal benchmarking and external benchmarking. Most of the organizations monitor their own performance in order to identify the change in the key business activities over time. They look at the performance of the organization as a whole and compare the performance of difficult individual teams or business units with each other. Performance monitoring is a continuous process and a very cumbersome process. Those with an interest in the organization's business will wish to compare the result over time in order to reveal the trends in the business performance of the company. This is the only way to discern whether performance is in line with the expectations or not. Part of this process will involve regular analysis of performance against target, example, financial performance budget, sales budget, production achievement against target, sales targets, etc. External benchmarking is a process by which the performance of the organization is compared with that of other organizations in the industry. The organizations need to decide what activities or dimensions of the organization should be compared with others. Who are the other organizations that are to be compared with our organization? How information on other organizations can be obtained? If these questions are answered, external benchmarking can be done. But it is a time-consuming process and it is hampered by the difficulty of obtaining relevant and pertinent information. There is also a problem of finding out comparable organizations to benchmark against. That's why most of the organizations wish to assess their own performance relative to their industry norms. They could do this with reference to the industry average based on the performance of the best performing organization. However, a danger in relying solely on the industry norm analysis is that the industry may itself perform badly. Obviously, the scope of cross-industry comparison will be more limited but could relate. For example, the employee cost or to research and development expenditure. Perhaps a good example of how to conduct benchmarking exercise comes from Xerox company. It has followed 10 steps according to a sequence. The first step is identification of what is to be benchmarked, identification of comparable companies, determining data collection methods and collect the data, determine current performance levels, project future performance levels, communicate benchmark results and gain acceptance, establish functional goals, develop action plans, implement action plans and monitor progress, and recalibrate benchmarks. Like general benchmarking, HR benchmarking is extremely important. When information on HR performance has been gathered, it must be compared to a standard, which is a model or measure against which something is compared to determine the performance level. For example, it is meaningless to know the organizational turnover rate is 75% if the turnover rates are comparable organizations are unknown. HR benchmarking compares specific measures of performance against data on those measures in other best practices organizations. HRD professionals are interested in benchmarking, trying to locate organizations that do certain activities extremely well and thus become the benchmark. HR benchmarking is useful for the following reasons. An organization can identify how its HR practices compare with the best practices. It helps organizations learn what type of HR practices work and they can be successfully implemented. They provide a basis for reviewing existing HR practices and develop new practices. They help managers to establish a strategy and set priorities for HR practices. Some of the common benchmark performance measures in HRD management are the compensation as percentage of net income before taxes, percent of management positions filled internally, rupee sales per employee, benefits as a percentage of payroll cost. Managers need to consider several things when doing benchmarking. They must gather information about internal processes to serve as a comparison for the best practice. To ensure the broadest information possible, managers should be careful to gather data from the companies both within and outside the industry. Benchmarking may actually limit a company's performance if the goal is only to learn and copy what competitors have done and not to consider various options to improve their processes. It is also important not to view. Examining recruitment practices also requires consideration of company's emphasis on use of company staffing strategy. The information collected needs to be considered in terms of the context of the companies. Finally, benchmarking is an important part of improvement process. As a result, use of information gathered from benchmarking needs to be considered in the broader framework of organizational change. The next concept which we are going to concentrate as a part of the HRD evaluation process is the use of balanced scorecard concept as a tool for HRD evaluation. The balanced scorecard concept is a management and measurement system which enables the organizations to clarify their vision and strategy and translate in them into action. The goal of balanced scorecard is to tie business performance to organization strategy by measuring the results in four important areas: financial performance, customer knowledge, internal business processes, and learning and growth. In 1992, an article by Robert Kaplan and David Norton entitled "The Balanced Scorecard Measures That Drive Performance" in the Harvard Business Review caused a lot of attention for their method and led to their business bestseller, The Balanced Scorecard, Translating Strategy into Action, published in 1996. The financial performance of an organization is essential for its success. Even non-profit organizations must deal in a sensible way with funds they receive. However, a pure financial approach for managing organizations suffers from two important drawbacks. It's historical. It tells us what has happened to the organization, but it may not tell us what is currently happening, nor it is a good conductor of future performance. The second drawback is that it is too low. It is common for the current market value of the organization to exceed the market value of its assets. Tobin's Q measures the ratio of the value of the company's assets to its market value. The excess value is resulting from intangible assets. This kind of value is not measured by normal financial reporting. The four perspectives of balanced scorecard, according to Robert Kaplan and David Norton, are financial perspective, how do we look to shareholders? Customer perspective, how do customers see us? Business process perspective, what must we excel at? Learning and growth perspective, can we continue to improve and create value? This allows the monitoring of present performance, but the method also tries to capture information about how well the organization is positioned to perform in the future. Let us have a look at the benefits of balanced scorecard. The benefits of balanced scorecard are focusing the whole organization on the few key things needed to create breakthrough performance. Helps to integrate various corporate programs such as quality, re-engineering, customer service initiatives, etc. It breaks down strategic measures towards lower levels so that unit level managers and operators can see what's required at their level to achieve excellent overall performance. The financial perspective. Kaplan and Norton do not disregard the traditional need for financial data. Timely and accurate funding data will always be a priority, and managers will make sure to provide it. In fact, there is often more than sufficient handling and processing of financial data. With the implementation of corporate database, it is hoped that more of the processing can be centralized and automated. But the point is that the current emphasis on financial issues leads to an unbalanced situation with regard to other perspectives. There is perhaps a need to include additional financial related data such as risk assessment, cost benefit data, etc. in this category. The customer perspective. Recent management philosophy has shown an increasing realization of the importance of customer focus and customer satisfaction by any company. These are called leading indicators. If customers are not satisfied, they will eventually find other suppliers that will meet their ends. Poor performance from this perspective is thus a leading indicator of a future decline of the organization. Even though the current financial picture may seem to be good, in developing metrics for satisfaction, customers also should be analyzed. In terms of kinds of customers and of the kinds of processes for which we are providing a product or service to those customer groups is to be studied. The business process perspective. This perspective refers to internal business processes. Measurements based on this perspective will show the managers how well their business is running and whether its products and services conform to customer requirements. These metrics have to be carefully designed by those who know these processes most intimately. In addition to the strategic management processes, two kinds of business processes may be identified: mission-oriented process and support processes. Mission-oriented processes are unique processes and they revolve around the mission of the enterprise. Support processes are those processes which are repetitive in nature and it is easier to measure and benchmark. Generic measurement methods can be used to measure these support processes. Learning and growth perspective. This perspective includes employee training and corporate cultural attitudes related to both individual and corporate self-improvement. In a knowledge-based organization, people are the main resource. In the current climate of rapid technological and economic changes, it is becoming necessary for knowledge workers to learn continuously. Government agencies often find themselves unable to hire new technical workers and at the same time show a decline in training of existing employees. Kaplan and Norton emphasize that learning is something more than training. It also includes things like mentoring, tutoring within the organization, as well as that of ease of communication among the workers to get ready help whenever it is needed. It also includes technological tools such as the internet. The integration of all these four perspectives into one picture, appealing picture, is used as a management methodology. For each perspective of the balanced scorecard, four things are monitored: objectives, the major objectives to be achieved, measures, the observable parameters that will be used to measure progress towards reaching the objective, targets, the specific target values for the measures. For example, 7% annual decline in manufacturing disruptions. Initiatives, projects and programs to be initiated in order to meet the objective. Organization results in each of these strategic areas determine if the organization is progressing towards the strategic objectives or not. For example, some firms have noticed that when survey results show a decline in employee satisfaction, several months later there is a decline in customer loyalty and repeat sales from customers. Expenditure in employee leadership development training can be linked to lower employee turnover and reduced time to hire managers from outside of the organization. More than 60% of the organization claim to use a balanced scorecard approach. Firms like Verizon, Mayo Clinic, etc. have used their approach to align performance measures with their organization strategy. Using the balanced scorecard requires spending considerable time and effort to identify the appropriate HR measures in each of the four areas and how they tie to strategic organizational success. The balanced scorecard should align with the company goals and focus on the results. To be effective, the HR scorecard should address three elements: accountability, validity, and actionable results. However, regardless of the time and effort spent trying to develop and use objective measures in balanced scorecard, subjectivity in what is selected and how the measures are interpreted can still occur. A human resource information system is another way to evaluate HRD. It is a system used to acquire, store, manipulate, analyze, retrieve, and distribute information related to the company's human resources. From the manager's perspective, an HRIS can be used to support strategic decision making, to avoid litigation, to evaluate programs and policies, or to support daily operating concerns. The system can be as large or as small as is necessary and may contain one or two modules or up to 20 or so. A lot of HRIS software packages are being marketed for both mainframe and microcomputers. In adopting a HRIS, the following issues need to be addressed: a careful need assessment, what type of HRIS and size of HRIS should be adopted, whether to develop software or buy and use off-the-shelf software, should the HRIS be implemented in total or in stages. It consists of the following subsystem: recruitment information, including placement data bank, advertisement module, general requirement and training requirement data, personal information relating to transfer monitoring and increment and promotion details of employees, manpower planning information, which seeks to provide information that could assist human resource mobilization, career planning, succession planning, and input for skill development. Training information. It provides information for designing course material, arrange for need-based training,
and cost analysis of training. Health information system. This subsystem of HRIS provides information for maintenance of health related activities of the employees. Appraisal information. It deals with performance appraisal and merit rating information, which serves as input for promotion, increment, succession planning and career planning. Payroll system. This consists of information concerning wages, salaries, incentives, perquisites and provident fund, etc. Data on compensation pattern of competitors are also included in it. Personal statistics system. It is a bank of historic and current data used for various type of analysis. P.N. Singh, in his Developing and Managing Human Resources article, says that 7 behavior-based indicators are constituted to form a new human resource information system to indicate the health of the organization. Psychofancy index. Dissent in present-day organization is not only discouraged but also curbed. Psychofans are those who flatter to get what they want. They can also be termed as yes men, and they contribute very little in making the organization great. Therefore, high level of psychofancy should serve as a warning to the management. So if there are more yes men, the management should understand that they are not going to contribute to the growth of the organization and curb their behavior. Self-development index. All development is self-development. The strength of an organization partly depends on how serious its employees are about their own development. Factors like how many employees are attending courses, how many books they are reading, etc. will be the index. Boredom index. Any employee, either newly recruited or posted to a new assignment, goes through the following stages: anxiety period, competence building period, confidence building period and boredom period. This is a level of saturation for the employee. Leadership index. Productivity depends to a greater extent on the quality of leadership at different hierarchy levels of the organization. Therefore, better the leadership, better the climate. Creativity index. In a modern and changing environment, one has to be creative to cope with competition from outside. The level of creativity in the organization is decided by the number of creative people in the organization and the number of innovations done in the organization by the employees. Executive stress index. Since executives play a crucial role in achievement of goals, stress for a short period may be functional. The executive stress index could be gauged from the number of key executives suffering from high blood pressure, etc. Therefore, less the stress, better the achievement. This executive stress index can be identified through regular medical camps for the executives. Parochialism index. Lastly, it can be stated that organizations will do very well if this index is lower and vice versa. This depends on the performance of cosmopolitan team. Parochialism refers to the narrow-mindedness of the employees. So, the lower the index, the better the organization. The last two indices, executive stress index and parochialism index, are not directly affected by technology and are hence called as technology independent indices. Other metrics or evaluation models that are recommended by American Society for Training and Development are total training expenditure per training eligible employee, training eligible employees to trainer ratio, percentage of training time via classroom, percentage of training time via learning technologies, total training hours per training eligible employee, total training expenditure, wages and salaries of full and part-time training staff as percentage of expenditure, payments to outside companies as percentage of expenditure, percentage of expenditure on learning technologies, return on expectations, knowledge or skill-based pay, individual development plans, skill certification, documentation of individual competencies. These metrics have been recommended by American Society for Training and Development, and the annual learning outcome report is also published by ASTD using different measures mentioned above. Fitch-Ens, Ulrich, Zenger, Smallwood and Kaplan and Norton have developed human resource metrics through various researches. These researchers have attempted to define key organization level indicators that provide a picture of development effectiveness across a broad sample of companies. These metrics demonstrate the value of organization level metrics used in balanced scorecard approach to HR accountability. Together, they provide a useful starting point. However, there are two primary flaws. They still tend to rely heavily on training as a key indicator, not the broader concept of development. Some are too complex to collect in large-scale surveys. For example, establishing employees' reputation with headhunters would be very difficult to do. A new horizon in metrics has been reached by independent non-profit organizations like staffing.org, which has taken the challenge of creating new international standard metrics for staffing, development and retention. This organization is attempting to improve on the existing metrics so that they are useful to the management for internal control and externally for benchmarking. Halton and Nakin used these criteria for establishing development metrics in the year 2000. Parsimonious. Development metrics should be a limited number of key criteria, not a lengthy scorecard. Halton and Nakin proposed 5 key development metrics, namely development quality, capacity to meet potential needs, development of customer satisfaction, formal development investment per employee, and human capital development contribution. Kirkpatrick model. This model of training evaluation has dominated the training evaluation discussion since it was first published in 1998. It suggests that training should be evaluated at 4 levels: participant reactions, learning, on-the-job behaviors, results from behavior change. The American Society for Training and Development has embraced this framework in its learning outcomes report. As part of its benchmarking service, participants provided data on standardized measures of level 1 and level 3 outcomes. When evaluation is done, the participant reaction form is the most frequently used vehicle. Despite its popularity with practitioners, in the recent years, the 4-level taxonomy has come under intense criticism. The chief criticisms are, it is not supported by research, the emphasis is on the reaction measures, the failure to update the model, it is not used widely by practitioners, it can lead to incorrect decisions. The other metrics used for evaluation are economic value added, human capital and intellectual contributions, etc. Evaluation, or accountability as it can be called, is the basic force that pushes the field to learn how to focus its resources. We can see no reason that HRD should not be held accountable just as marketing, production, engineering or any other department. This accountability will help in advancement of this profession. At the end of this episode, let me give you a short assignment to feed your thought. Why do you think there is such resistance to evaluate results of HRD interventions? Or why is there much resistance for evaluating HRD interventions? Keep me posted with your assignments. Bye for now.